It's time to babble the fuck on. Live from the John Lovitz Podcast Theater, it's Hollywood Babylon. With your hosts, Kevin Smith and Ralph Garman.
It is Saturday night in Hollywood, so let's babble the fuck on. I'm Kevin Smith.
I'm Ralph Garman. See?
Well, there goes my depression.
These people are nice.
Fucking sold out show again. Thanks, folks. But I literally just showed up and fucking before we went, he was like, what's wrong, Kev? I was like, I'm just a little blue. I was communicating just a little thing I was blue about. Like one of these, like, nobody likes me. Everybody hates me.
He was literally eating worms. That's the other half of that.
Is it?
Yeah.
I thought
nobody
it was.
Nobody likes me, everybody hates me. I'm going to go eat some worms.
No.
Yeah.
The way I was taught when I was a kid was nobody likes me, everybody hates me, I should go suck cock.
Oh, that's...
5 years old, that's the way I've been singing it since then.
A worm of a different kind,
I guess.
That's all.
But I was feeling a little blue, and then we came home to out to this. Holy Christ, what a wonderful reaction.
Yeah, so, look at everybody. Hi there.
Before we go into Hollywood news and whatnot, can I communicate a cultural thing that I found out about today?
Sure.
I went to a bat mitzvah. You know what that is?
I do. That's where Batman and Robin get
yes!
together. And they read from the Torah. And
that's what I thought, man.
I believe it's bat in the Hebrew. It's bat mitzvah.
Batman?
No. It's Batman.
Who are you fucking Bane? Well, Batman.
It's Batman, but it's bat mitzvah.
Is it?
Yes.
I went to one of those today. Girl version of the bar mitzvah, which is way easier to communicate. Bar mitzvah, everyone knows. You go bat mitzvah, they're like bar. And you're like, no, it's bat mitzvah. They're like, does that have something to do with Batman and Robin? And the same fucking thing. So I go, this is something I'd never been to one.
Never?
Never. It's weird.
Don't you know any Jews?
No.
Come to work in Hollywood.
I guess it's weird, right? I guess they just don't feel comfortable inviting me to shit because they're like, I'll probably wear that fucking hockey jersey.
Yeah.
Which I didn't. I wore a suit jacket today.
What the fuck?
I did. I didn't want to stand out. It's like, you know, it was my daughter Harley's friend, Hannah.
Right.
It's her special day. You know, she's becoming a woman, so to speak, and whatnot. I don't want to show up and everyone's like, I don't even know who he is, but look at that shirt, you know. So I just want to keep the focus on her. I put on a standard kind of suit jacket, so instead of looking like colorful fat guy, I just look like standard issue fat guy. So I went, and this blew my mind. At the end, the rabbi or whatever, the rabbi.
Yeah.
But they call them something, Mal something. Like I was like Mola Ram, and I was like, holy shit, this motherfucker gonna rip a heart out, you know? He didn't.
You must have been so disappointed.
It was more about education. Like, they're people, they really like to break open the scrolls and understand them. They're intellectuals and shit. I was looking for human sacrifice.
Yeah.
And
different religion.
Yeah.
You're thinking Mormons.
Or in the Catholic, The Catholic Church were always like, nail him up, eat his flesh, drink his blood, metal, you know. So this was weird to me. I never knew this. At the end, the rabbi's like, he's explaining. He's like, look, we're going to hold our hands up in prayer, but how we do it is we hold it like this.
Yeah.
And he goes, now, is anybody? And he's very, it was fun because he's interactive with the crowd and shit. He would throw out questions, you could answer them. So, like,
was he a stand-up rabbi?
Was he doing
a chunk?
Oh, totally. Like somebody at one point was just like, he was just like, you know, something, life is ephemeral. Does anybody know what that means? I'm sitting there going, I think it means fleeting and shit, but I don't want to jump up and say something in case it means something else.
Right.
A little girl raises her hand, like 13-year-old kid. He's like, you. And she's like, fleeting? And he's like, yes, it means fleeting. And everyone applauded for her. I was like, why didn't I say something? I could have beat this fucking idiot to the punch, and I would have been king of the fucking
Nobody
bat mitzvah, man.
Nobody likes me. Everybody hates me. That's what you're thinking.
But instead, man, he was just like, okay, does anybody know what this means? And I was like, here's my chance.
Oh, you didn't. Please tell me you didn't.
I did. I just wanted to be like, Vulcan greetings.
Live long and prosper.
I didn't look up or anything, but he literally jumped on. He goes, somebody say Vulcan? I was like, yeah. Yeah.
Maybe.
Like, it is from Star Trek. He's going, you know, Mr. Spock. And he said that. He goes, Mr. Spock, who just happens to be Jewish, which made me laugh because the song, the fucking Adam Sandler song where he's like, oh, Captain Kirk and Mr. Spock, both Jewish.
Yeah.
So he goes, he just happens to be Jewish. He's going, he brought that to the character. And he's going, and that's literally how we pray. And he's going,
Nimoy got it from being a Jew. Yeah.
That's what he's, I had no fucking clue. And he goes, and what is the prayer that Spock usually says or the greeting that he gives? And this I fucking had, you know. It's right. Like, if there was a buzzer on the table, I would have fucking pounded it.
You would have gone to the bonus round.
Holy shit, man. I couldn't even let him finish it before. I was like, live long and prosper, bitch. You know, I forgot we were at a kid's bat mitzvah, but...
This is why no one invites you to bat mitzvahs, by the way.
Pretty much.
You're screaming out answers.
That's wild, man. In the Jewish church, you can go around doing this shit, man.
It's I'm not like convert it's not the Jewish church, by the way.
What is it?
It's the temple.
Oh.
Yeah.
They might not let me in.
They might not let you in. Good thing you didn't wear the hockey jersey.
On the Jewish holodeck, you get away with doing this.
Nope. Once again, wrong show.
So. Yeah.
I grew up in Philadelphia, Northeast Philadelphia, of course, and my neighborhood was predominantly Jewish. I was like the token goyim, as they say.
Get out of here. Yeah. You must have gotten so much pussy.
Yeah, I did.
You and them big balls of yours, man.
How do you think they got so big?
Fucking, you were a goy toy, dude?
I was a goy toy, yeah. So I went to, when I was 13, I went to like a bar or bat mitzvah a week. I mean, just constantly. I just went to a ton of them to the point where I learned, I probably know more prayers in Hebrew than I do in English. Baruch atah Adonai melcheinu melech haolam.
You're right.
Yeah. That's one of the prayers.
I see you as the guy that shows up to all the bat mitzvahs and shit, and after ceremony's done, they're into the dancing part of it and shit.
Yeah.
You're pulling the girl into the cloakroom going, now you're going to be a woman. The goy toy is here. Look at these balls.
I'm circumcised too, ladies. It's not just members of the tribe.
Yeah, I got cut for Christ.
It's a bumper sticker in the back of my car, actually. Cut for Christ. Honk if you're clipped. All right, let's get to the segment of the show where we say hello to and give some greetings to people who have come particularly long distances or are celebrating special occasions tonight. It's a segment we call The Shoutouts.
It's a shout-out with Kevin and Brown, so get your cock out. Yeah, yeah. Get your cock out.
Don't bite. Don't use your teeth. No.
It was like Tom Hanks and Big with the little corn.
Yeah. Remember when he tasted the caviar?
Yeah.
That's my favorite part. He's like wiping his tongue off. I love that part. As always, we get a ton of requests for shout-outs, and we just simply cannot read them all out loud. So if we don't get to yours tonight, we apologize. But you could
disappointment.
We should get a new jingle. Odds are you're not getting shout-outs. How about Edgar? Edgar Aguirre?
Yeah, damn you, Shocktopus!
And to you, sir.
Is that your fucking greeting?
That's, yeah, that's what we say in the temple, yes. Damn you, Shocktopus. It's the greeting in my temple. Edgar writes, my name is Edgar, and I'll be at the show for my birthday weekend. Along with me is my buddy Angel, my brother Jay, and his buddy Eric. Jay and Eric are so gay for each other.
Get your cock out.
Song's appropriate. In your Charlton Heston voice, can you tell these two closeted homos to get it over with and just fuck each other? If you could have Kevin in the background doing his sucking cock noise, that would make it even more special.
Thanks for thinking of me, man.
Garmy Strong, Edgar. So you're just assuming these gentlemen want to be with each other. You don't know for a fact, right? Trust me. Trust me.
When you assume, you're getting ass from you and me.
I guess so.
Nom, nom, nom.
The love between two men is as old as man himself.
So don't feel ashamed if you want to get close with another man. In ancient Greece, it was considered normal for a man to love another man. Ah. You can take a man's cock away from me when you pry it from my cold, dead hands. So feel free. It's a bathhouse, a bathhouse! And scene. Thank you so much, Edgar. How about our friends from Chicago, Chris, Michelle, Pat, and Eric? Are you guys here? Fuck yeah.
Hey, to think about it for a second.
Are we here? Yeah, we're here. Come on, we rehearsed the fuck yeah. Get it right. We tried this in the parking lot. It was better in the parking lot. We're pumped to see the show. We came to L.A. to meet up with Eric and see how the L.A. life is treating him. He's a body double these days. That means gay porn, right?
Sometimes on the weekends.
That's how we all start. He worked on the Green Lantern movie. However, we're not terribly proud of him because that movie was terrible.
Who did you double in Green Lantern?
You were doubled
you
Ryan Reynolds?
Was double? So when you say he's double, like the lighting guy, so like when he was in the trailer, you were standing there and they were lighting the show? Not the standard. So what do you mean double?
Boner features? What? Oh, bonus features.
Sir, I've been in films for almost 20 years. There's no such department as boner features. If that's what Ryan Reynolds told you, he lied and shot Canadian cum all over you.
Wait a minute. So they shot additional footage for the DVD and you were his body double for those sequences?
It was stills.
It was stills.
Right on, man.
Concept art. This is getting murkier and murkier, this whole fucking story. They were sketching you in the nude, sir, basically is what happened. So do you have Ryan Reynolds' abs and all that kind of stuff? Pull your shirt up. Let's see your abs. Let's see if you're going to... Come on, let's see the abs.
Do it. Do
oh, my
it,
God.
Do it. Do it.
Jeez, that is boner material right there. He was right. We need Kevin as Bane, they write, to urge Eric not to disgrace us with a movie like The Green Lantern again.
Oh.
Bane, can you straighten him out?
Yes. It's Eric?
It's Eric, yes.
Fuck.
Uh-huh, not so easy,
no,
is
it really
when they put
isn't.
You on the spot?
And I've got, like, one impression.
I know. You think you'd have something
can't
ready.
Rock it. It's Eric, okay.
It's Eric, yeah.
Eric, why don't you...
You're goofy, Bane.
Why don't you stop making crap movies?
There we go, Eric.
What?
From Bane himself.
You cut my impression off,
oh,
dude.
I'm sorry.
I was going to go places with it, man.
Yeah, I'm sure
Charlton
you were.
Charlton Heston took 10 minutes. I got 20 seconds.
I thought we were lucky you got that out.
Never mind.
No, finish up.
I got nothing left. When Gotham is in ashes... And you have my permission to die.
How about Brian from Arizona? Are you here, Brian from Arizona? All right, sit down, Brian from Arizona. Made the trek from Arizona to Hollywood to clear my name and figured sharing my rusty sheriff's badge idea would get me a place in the show. We talked about this earlier. We're trying to come up with a signature drink here for the Hollywood Babylon show here at the Lovitz. And we thought we're going to call it the Rusty Sheriff Badge. And we've asked people to send in their recipes for the Rusty Sheriff Badge. We got a shit ton of them, by the way, so no more recipes for the Rusty Sheriff Badge. We're currently combing through them, and we will have a contest at some point on the show. We'll taste them and see which one we choose. Brian sent in his recipe. His is 6 ounces of light beer, 1/2 ounce of Grey Goose vodka, 1/2 ounce of cognac, and 1/2 ounce of Kahlua or chocolate liqueur. That sounds fucking undrinkable. Each 1/2 ounce is dropped in a shot glass, and then dropped into a beer bomb style. I'm sorry. That's just vomitous. I'm sorry. That's just... But we'll try that one. We'll try that one.
Yeah,
Brian,
this is for a drink that's named after an asshole, you got to aim higher.
Brian says he worked on this while playing the drinking game and listening to the podcast. He said it may not taste good because after 10 podcasts, he could no longer understand words.
My suggestion was Yoo-hoo and vodka.
That's pretty strong.
Yeah, straightforward.
People are groaning. That sounds all right. You can mix vodka with any. As a former mixologist myself, I know for a fact you can take vodka and mix it with any fucking thing and people will drink it. Except me, yes. I would serve it to the suckers, but I would not drink it myself, no. But Brian also let us know that, unfortunately, the rusty sheriff's badge is not ours and ours alone. Apparently, that is a common phrase. He said in this photo, to prove it, this is actually a series of movies. This is the second in line of Wreck My Rusty Sheriff Badge. Very popular series with the people who enjoy adult entertainment. Starring Sarah Ashley, and she does great work, by the way, Sarah Ashley.
It's Western-themed porn, yes?
It is, I believe.
Presumably she's playing the sheriff?
I'm guessing.
Why would she want anyone to fuck with her badge?
I think you're missing the point of the movie.
But even, I get it, she wants her asshole fucked. But
yes.
Even, it's still confusing.
No, it's not, really.
Her thesis is off, man.
No, like, it isn't. When she says, fuck my ass, I think everyone in the movie understands what she's talking about.
Yeah,
no
but
confusion.
At one point in the movie, she says, fuck my rusty sheriff's badge.
Yeah.
Confusing in the Old West.
Yeah, probably. Is Chuck Sanford here? Chuck?
Win it.
No one hears no Sanford and Son. All right, I think we all got it. Chuck is here with his wife Jen and his friends Aaron and Jim. They are all from Northeast Philadelphia, by the way. My hometown and my neighborhood in my hometown. You guys are from the Mayfair area, if I'm not mistaken? Where exactly in Mayfair are you from? Tyson and the Boulevard. No, well, you know the Tyson Theater? No? Is it there anymore? It's not there anymore. There used to be a theater there, right there at Tyson the Boulevard.
They're from your neighborhood?
Yes.
You guys Jewish? Did Ralph fuck you?
No, see, Common Avenue was the dividing line. Like, everyone who was on one side of Common was mostly the Irish and the Catholics, and then the other side of Common was the Jews and stuff as you worked your way up the boulevard.
Who was, as a youth, I'm sure in high school, they were like, these girls fuck the most. Like, who was it, the Catholic girls or the Christian girls or the Jewish girls?
The Jewish girls would blow you. The Catholic girls would fuck you.
With, really?
With, were you going to ask what they were going to fuck with?
I went to
their vaginas, Kevin.
I'm still stuck on the rusty fucking sheriff's badge. I went to Catholic school. There wasn't a whole lot of fucking going on. Maybe just because it was me. But
a lot of the girls, I went to a public school.
Yeah.
And so the Catholic girls who were in public school were largely thrown out of Catholic school.
They had
problems
like,
with the nuns or whatever, you know, so they were a little racier.
And you'd be like in detention with them, you're like, why'd you get kicked out of school, Catholic school? And they were like sucking balls. And you were like, I have massive balls. I don't know
I
if you've ever heard.
Tangerines in my pants. my name is Chuck. We covered that. Chuck, his wife Jen.
And
friends
I like
Aaron
to
and
fuck.
Jim. Aaron and Jim, Jim, by the way, is a Devils fan.
Right on, man.
You
fuck
live
you.
In. Yeah, first of all, you're in the wrong fucking town to be a Devils fan.
Why? They should welcome the Devils here, man. They led them to a fucking Stanley Cup.
That's true. So you live in Philly and you're a Devils fan? Or you live in Jersey? Oh, okay. We're flying to L.A. on Saturday morning, stopping at HBO for the first time on our way to Vegas. So you guys just got here this morning? Oh, you must be exhausted. Please make it funny so we won't fall asleep. Oh, I guess they are tired. Jen and I are celebrating our 5th year anniversary on Friday, and we were hoping that Adam West could ask the McDonald's fry girl her insight on a successful marriage. P.S., our friend Brett is also a huge Babylon fan, and he is pissed he got left in Philly, and we're here without him. Could the fry girl give him a shout-out with, I thought it was cool? Well, I would like to do all that stuff for you, Chuck, but unfortunately, I'd rather read this next email. Dear Ralph and Kev, by now you've probably read the email from my buddy Chuck in regards to the 5th year wedding anniversary they are currently celebrating out on the West Coast. Who's the guy you left behind? I'm trying to think. Brett is his name, right? Yeah. Chuck is in the theater tonight with three HBO virgins, one of which gives up her rusty wagon wheel on a fairly regular basis. This would be Chuck's most giving wife, Jen. Yeah, Brett is really pissed. To be honest, she gives up the chocolate starfish so much that it probably should be referred to as the rusty donkey wheel. And she would probably be too big for Liam Neeson's cock. She's a trooper and deserves a hand. However, the other two HBO virgins in the house are friends of mine that Chuck and Jen have stolen. I'll explain, perhaps some sad Hulk music to set the mood, he says. James? My wife and I were planning to go on that vacation with Chuck and Jen so we could celebrate their 5-year wedding anniversary together and renew our vows in Vegas. But some asshole after I left after a stay in LA. But then my wife and I had a child and all our priorities shifted, so much so that we could no longer afford the trip. But Chuck and Jen then decided to take friends of ours, Jim and Aaron, on the trip instead. Well, only knowing them for a short amount of time. And then he gets HBO tickets without me and rubs it in my face? What a bastard. So I was wondering if we could initiate Jim and Aaron into the HBO circle and have Nick Cage ask Aaron if she could give up her rusty wagon wheel, as Jen does so often for Jimbo, in honor of Chuck and Jen's holy matrimony. Much love to you, Brett from Northeast Philly. So apparently he is upset with you.
This shit's getting complex.
It is, like, yeah.
It's like a modern day version of The Notebook.
I really think you should give up your asshole. Trust me, everyone in Los Angeles does it.
You're more of an asshole protector.
I'm more of an asshole protector.
How about Nick, Trevor, Johnny, and Dan? Are you guys here? Wow, right up front.
Right up front, man.
Can you please send a huge birthday shout out to my good friend Dan as your Bowie? It's his 30th birthday, and we want to let him know, fuck all if it doesn't go on a slow downward spiral from this point on. And we love him. Thank you, sir. And Nick, Trevor, and Johnny. P.S. Fucking downward spiral. I think we can do that, James. Can we get a little Bowie?
It's all over for you now, Dan. It's all over for you now, Dan. When you turn 30, it's all over. Fucking downward spiral. Happy birthday, Daniel. Your fucking life is over. It's all over for you, Dan. Now that you have turned 30. It's all over now for you, Dan. Now that you have turned 30. It's all over now, you're 30. It's all over for you, Daniel.
All right, there you go. You've never involved me before in that dance. That was creepier than usual.
Sometimes you just gotta take your passion and make it happen.
Yeah. We also get emails from around the world, and that's why we read them out loud.
Ain't no drag.
Garvin's got an email bag.
Featuring Kevin's reactions.
Britt from Canada writes, my boyfriend Scott, our good friend Charles, and I wanted to get Garmy shirts to show our support for the Garmy and all it stands for. But we were super disappointed to see a huge American flag on it. Any self-respecting Canadian is less than thrilled to sport the red, white, and blue. Any love for the Canadian Garmy? Much love, Britt. Listen, Canada.
Oh.
No, here, I love Canada. We had a great time in Ottawa. We just did a show there a
you
couple weeks ago.
You were welcomed like a fucking... The king of Canada.
I know.
If there is such a thing.
Here's the thing. The Garmy shirt does have a flag on it, but it's not really supposed to be like an American thing. It's a spoof of a movie called Patton many years ago. It's George C. Scott who played a general, General George Patton, and he does this famous monologue in front of a giant flag, and he's wearing the helmet and everything. That's what the image is a spoof of. It really has nothing to do with America per se. And I was thinking about it when we first made the shirts. I was like, maybe we should make a flag for Canada, and then we have fans in the UK do a British a Union Jack version and like a Swedish version. And then as I thought about it, I said, that sounds like a fucking lot of work. So I said, fuck it. And so you do not get a Canadian t-shirt is what I'm saying, basically.
No?
No. However, we do have brand new Hollywood Babylon shirts.
Okay.
That we're happy to premiere tonight as we go into our third year. We had the Babylon shirts for a long time, just Kevin and I as ourselves with a caricature of us that we love. A guy named Michael Waite does it out of the UK and does great
adorable
work.
Little cartoon versions of us.
But we thought as we go into the new year, we'd start doing like limited edition t-shirts with Kevin and I as famous duos from movies. So every shirt, we're going to make just a limited number, and then we're going to sell them out, and then we're going to do a brand new image. We're going to keep doing it until we run out of famous movie duos. So we're starting off with a brand new shirt, starting off with it tonight. This is the new shirt that we're putting on. This is us from... This is the Ghost Babblers t-shirt with me as a Ghostbuster and Kevin as Slimer eating a hot dog and fries. So
I wasn't even insulted by that.
It's awesome, right?
When I saw it, I was like, you know what? I'll take it, man.
Yeah. So you can get that tonight, starting tonight, and also it'll be up at the GarmyStrong.com website. So Britt, Canadians love the Ghostbusters, right, Britt?
Here, man.
We do. Thank you, Britt. So she'll be happy in Canada with that instead.
If we go, but when we go back to Canada, yes. We will bring a certain number of Garmy t-shirts that with
the Canadian flag.
You have to, man. You have to.
Really?
Yeah, and it's easy. Listen to you. You're like, that sounds like a lot of work.
Yeah.
You call someone, you go, make this happen. And that's how it happens.
Maybe in your world, Kevin Smith, with your team of people running willy-nilly, making you happy.
Making t-shirts is easy.
I'm a one-man operation over here.
Yeah, I've seen you. Your one-man operation pre-show is just like, please let me fucking do this tonight. Let me make them come like myself.
Stop it.
Downward tug into the toilet pre-show. It's fucking sad, man. It reminds me of like Raging Bull, where he's just like in the mirror and shit, talking to himself pre-show.
Just getting up for the fight.
Yeah, that's how you get up for the fight, by tugging down.
Speaking of Canada, Jeff Butler from Ontario writes, I have a confession, and please don't tell my wife. I've been secretly letting my 12-year-old son listen to Babylon on the way to his football games and practices.
Oh, that's cute,
it's
man.
It's not
they're
cute.
Bonding.
It's Why? Inappropriate.
No.
He's 12.
My father used to bring me Red Fox albums. It was awesome. That's kind of cool.
Look what happened to you.
Yeah. Good point. He's got to stop.
Yes. I'm wondering if Arnold Schwarzenegger could tell his team, go Wolverines, crush your enemies. Thanks, and please don't tell my wife, Jeff Butler from Ontario, Canada.
Go Wolverines, crush your enemies. Don't tell mom, though, that you're listening to this. Also, don't tell her that dad is fucking the housekeeper. Unless he gets her pregnant. And then all bets are off, trust me. Can't fucking believe it.
Are you talking to me as, hey, Mr. Schwarzenegger?
Hey, Kevin Smith, how are you? I'm a huge fan of your work.
Thanks, man, likewise.
Yeah. I'd like you to make another movie called Austrian Girl. Like your Jersey Girl movie?
I got you. I made the connection.
Only this one, she's Austrian.
I followed along pretty damn closely there, Governator.
This next one's for you, Kev. This is not funny, but I thought it was poignant, and I thought it needed to be read.
Sad Hulk music?
No, it's not Sad Hulk music.
Okay.
It's uplifting, I think. This comes from...
Happy Hulk music? No, it's more like
Is that Sammy Davis Jr. as the Hulk?
He's feeling good, man. He's walking good.
David Banner is having a good day. My name is Joseph Rodriguez, and I'm a 15-year-old writer from Phoenix, Arizona. I have my own movie review website called Bosco's Grindhouse, and I've been a huge fan of Babylon for about a year now. Once again, too young. I wrote an article a few months back about something that happened to me on a train in Phoenix. I have a pretty severe stutter, and when asking for my ticket, I wasn't able to explain to the officer on the train that my reduced fare pass was purchased because I was under 18. The officer then humiliated me in front of everyone and forced me to get off the train. The entire time it happened, I was thinking about Kevin and his airline incident. While my audience isn't as big as his, I was able to stir up enough controversy to get an apology from the head of the security system that hired this man, all because Kevin inspired me to take a stand. Thank you again for making me laugh my ass off at times, and as well as keep inspiring me to stay strong and motivating me no matter what. Joseph.
Oh, right on.
How about that?
What I learned from Kev Smith, cry like a bitch until someone apologizes. Until
someone says they're sorry, and then still don't fucking go on their airline.
Yeah, totally.
Back to the anal jokes. Kyle from Portland, Oregon writes, longtime listener since day one, recently introduced to my coworker Greg, who I carpool with, to the podcast. He likes it so much that he's actually gone back to the first episode to get all caught up. He loves Anne Heche's dirty sheriff's badge. Now you're just confusing things. And I shared it with him. He shared with me a term for it that I'd never heard before. I laughed so hard, I told him I had to share it with you guys because it's too funny to keep it to myself. He calls the asshole the leather Cheerio. I like it.
It's kind of cute.
Yeah, we might have to incorporate that.
It's also friendly.
How so?
You ain't open up the fucking cheeks. Cheerio. Positively European, man.
This next email caught me completely by surprise. Dear Ralph and Kevin, I think you guys are great. But who I think is really great is DJ James.
Whoa, you got a fan, man. Signed, DJ James.
Yes. That's why it caught me by surprise, this email. He didn't think I'd put two and two together. He has the kind of sexy voice that makes you want to come hard.
Whoa.
Signed, Bill. No, I kid. If he could say hello to me, it would make me the happiest girl in the world. Love, Belle. James, can you say hello to Belle for us?
Only if Kevin does the
Now you've gone and sullied it, James.
Yes,
one email and you've ruined it.
I've ruined it.
Send a little message out to Belle.
Belle, we thank you for listening. We appreciate you listening. Yes.
Well, she's over that crush. This comes from Orion. What a great name is Orion, by the way.
Let me see. Oh, my God, you're right.
How cool would that be named Orion?
Pretty badass, man.
With a name like Orion, you got to get something fucking done with your life. You can't just sit around. Your name's Orion.
I was testing your thesis in my head, going like, wait a second, man. Is there anyone I know named Orion that hasn't done anything cool?
Orion's like one of the new gods, isn't he? Orion.
Yeah, he is. He's definitely one of the new gods. Yeah. But more than that, you know, it's
he's
just
the hunter. He's a constellation well. Is named after him, for God's sake.
Yeah.
This week, guys, I heard sources close to John Travolta say he wants to star in a big comic book movie franchise to try to repair his image and career. It seems to me this character would be perfect for him. This is a real superhero in the DC Comics universe who first appeared in Sensation Comics number 1 in January 1942 and was created by Gardner Fox and Howard Purcell. I had no idea this existed, but this is honest to God. This is real. Can we get a picture of this hero, please, that actually exists? There's a real superhero apparently called the Gay Ghost. I kid you not.
So weird. All the times we talked about it, and he's real.
Isn't that strange?
Where? It's a gay ghost. He carries a sword.
Listen to me, Mr. Johnson.
He swallows the sword.
If your family wants to keep this inheritance, you have to spend the night in this haunted house, and it's haunted by
the gay ghost.
How will we know it's the gay ghost? You'll hear him by his call sign.
Boom. It's so weird. I only stab you in one place. The leather Cheerio.
See, it's friendly.
See?
Yeah.
He's a nice ghost.
Totally.
Dude, there's a gay ghost comic book hero.
It's awesome. Somebody told me that on Twitter. I was like, fuck.
You might have to make one more movie. If they're going to make a superhero movie, the one for you is the gay ghost.
So wait, but I can't cast John Travolta. I have to cast you as John Travolta?
Yes.
It's so weird. I pierced your sphincter. What? Where? In your ass.
This last email comes from David from Yorkshire, England. I have a little request. I've listened to every episode, and for the life of me, I cannot remember there ever being a John Lovitz creepy clown. Either this is a travesty or me being thoughtless. If it's the latter, please feel free to call me a twat. I wouldn't do that, David, because we haven't done the John Lovitz creepy clown, so I think it's creepy clown time, Kevin.
Creepy clown time?
Creepy clown time. Alright. Creepy clown time. Kevin's afraid of clowns. This is a clown putting his makeup on before he does something evil. John Lovitz is the clown.
Make sure you call Obama an asshole in there somewhere.
There you go. There's your creepy clown for this week.
It was wonderful.
I was so hoping he'd be here tonight so we could pull him up and have him do it himself.
It was wonderful, but you didn't put on makeup once. The hand was all the way out here. Essentially, it was just John Lovitz.
Dude. Every week, we say goodbye to some people in show business who absolutely need a fond farewell. This week is no different. The segment, Tinseltown Stiffs.
And now, another edition of
Tinseltown Stiffs.
They will be missed.
Get your hands off the paperwork.
I want to see who died.
Well, you'll find out, along with the rest of us. This week, legendary songwriter Hal David passed away at the age of 91.
Holy fuck, man. Lucky fucking bastard. 91 is a huge bucket of wind, man.
It's a good run, yeah.
Totally. Well, huge.
He was suffering the past year after having a stroke. He was suffering.
All right, but 90 fucking excellent
I'd rather
years.
Go at 90 quick than 91 all Dick Clark. You know what I'm saying? What? You'd rather be all strokey? No, you wouldn't. I'm just speaking the truth, people.
You wouldn't be speaking the truth at that point.
No, I'd be.
Oh, stop. Oh, you're going
to
make
it
happen.
I used to work with Dion Bulbic.
Oh, don't.
Bob Bacharach said to me,
you're going
what
to
the world needs now is Bob, Sweet Bob.
Oh. What were the songs?
What the World Needs Now is Love, Sweet Love. That was one of his. He worked with Dionne Warwick largely, he and Burt Bacharach. They started in 1962, and they had a string of hits that was sort of unheard of in the 60s. Walk On By, Say a Little Prayer, Do You Know the Way to San Jose, of course, a famous song.
Say a Little Prayer?
Yeah.
Say a little prayer for me.
You.
Anyone Has a Heart, Always Something There to Remind Me, that was done by Simply Red, of course, redone. They won Grammys and Tonys. They wrote a musical called Promises, Promises. But probably their biggest song was the song they won an Oscar for in 1969. It was the song that really was part of what still today is one of my favorite movies of all time. Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid. They wrote the song, Raindrops Keep Falling on My Head. If you're not familiar, here's a little footage from the movie featuring the song. Here's Paul Newman and Catherine Ross.
Raindrops are falling on my head, and just like the guy whose feet are too big for his bed, nothing seems to fit. Those raindrops are falling on my head, they keep falling.
What a great tune. I love that movie.
Catherine
Ross. How hot is Catherine Ross in that movie?
I love that movie so much. I stole that song, put it in Clerks 2. When Dante and Randall were driving around on the go-karts, we used that song as well, which I loved. But then the same year, fucking Spider-Man used it. And I think it was the disco Spider-Man.
It was emo Spider-Man.
It might have been. It might have been Spider-Man too. I can't remember. But somebody else used it at the same time. But love that fucking song. And I love that movie. That movie's amazing. If you haven't seen Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, don't be put off by the fact that it was made like in the 70s or has an older look to it. The script is so fucking crisp. Number one, it's a period piece, so it doesn't matter what year it was actually made. It kind of looks like the year it was set in. But you're talking about two actors at the prime of their game, man. Yeah. Robert Redford and Paul Newman are just fucking magic, and it's got a script by Bill Goldman. It's got that score he wrote the lyrics, but who's the other? Burt Bacharach does the whole fucking score. It's a fantastic flick, man. Check it out. A lot of people avoid it because, like, oh, it's old timey. It still works.
Yeah,
like,
absolutely.
It's so fucking biting. It's crazy.
And Catherine Ross is just so sexy in that film.
She is.
She's ridiculous. They're both kind of in love with her. And
she makes you want to ride a bike.
Yeah, she does.
Which is saying a lot for a fat guy, man. Yeah.
Well, we're talking about musical celebrities who have passed away. This is the reason we do Tinseltown Stiffs, because a guy like this deserves to give a send-off. People didn't really know him that well. His name was Joe South. He was a singer, songwriter, musician, a guitarist, a legendary session guitarist. He played on Aretha Franklin's Chain of Fools. He played on Bob Dylan's Blonde on Blonde album. He was a songwriter. He was a singer. He had a Grammy in 1970 for the Song of the Year for a song called Games People Play. I don't know if you know that song or not, but here's a little taste of his biggest hit. But his biggest hit was actually written for somebody else. He wrote a song for a country star, Lynn Anderson.
Oh, I know who that is.
You know that
song? Rose Garden?
Rose Garden. Yeah. He actually wrote that for her. And here's a little taste if you're not familiar with that song. Here's that song.
I beg your pardon. I never promised you a rose garden along with the sunshine. There's gotta be a little rain sometime.
That song always makes me think of my mom.
It's so fucking weird that you say that, man. I was literally thinking as my eyes were closed, I was like, song really makes me think of my mother. It's weird.
Kumbaya, my lord, kumbaya.
Both our mothers are alive, yes?
Yes.
We acted like they were gone.
We're having a seance for live people. Well, my mom, when she was cleaning the house, put that fucking song on the turntable. Over and over and over again. I think she bought the 45 or she had the album or something, but I just remember my youth being haunted by the fucking Rose Garden song.
Do you think she was like constantly playing it as a message to your father?
Maybe. Our life sucks. And lastly this week, just one of the best guys I ever met. I was lucky enough to meet this guy on an occasion. He was the gentle giant, just a big, big heart. His name was Michael Clark Duncan, you know.
Yeah.
Star of the Green Mile. What an amazing performance in the Green Mile. Talk about making a splash in your debut, really. Maybe he had done other stuff before that. I don't remember. But when I saw that film, I was like, who is that guy and how is he so brilliant?
He was also the Kingpin.
I didn't share any space with him, but
we were in the movie.
Not a lot of people shared space with him, by the way.
Yeah.
He was like 6'5", 350. I mean, just a massive man.
I remember he had a heart attack a few months back or something.
He never recovered from that. That's what it was. He was in the hospital from that point on. He had his heart attack on July the 13th. He was in the hospital for 53 days before he finally succumbed to the damage that it had done to his heart.
Oh,
he was engaged, believe it or not, to Omarosa from The Apprentice.
I don't know who that is, but didn't she save his life when he had the heart attack?
She gave him CPR when he had the heart attack. She got him to the hospital, but he was never able to recover from the damage that was done to his heart because of the heart attack.
Bummer.
This story gets sadder. I mean, they were making wedding plans when he died, which is brutal. But this is the creepiest part for me, is that there's a 32-year-old woman now named Marque Ambrose who has come forward and claims that he is her father. And in her words, she said, "We haven't spoken in 11 years, but I want what's mine," she said. So apparently she's trying to get some money from his estate, whatever's left. She's trying to put some claim into his money.
Oh.
Word is that she even had the balls to phone his 93-year-old mother the day after he died, asking about the inheritance, whether there was any money in it for her.
Something went on there, huh?
Yeah. If she indeed is his daughter. They haven't even proven that yet. But she had 53 days to visit in the hospital, and the family said she never showed up.
The good news is this. He's beyond all that now, man. And the dude left behind a performance legacy that can't be trifled with. Huge bucket of win for him, man.
However, to add insult to injury, the story gets even a little sadder.
No.
Yeah. The NBC affiliate in Buffalo, New York, ran the story Monday night when Michael Clark Duncan passed away. I brought in the footage, the actual footage from the news report, where they talk about the death of Michael Clark Duncan. See as you watch it, if you can spot anything that may be wrong with their coverage of his passing.
The mayor's been suffering the heart attack on July 13th.
Oh, no.
The 6'5" yeah. No. Tom Duncan appeared in dozens of yeah. films, including such box yeah. office hits as Armageddon,
oh, my
Planet of the
God.
Apes,
they
and
think
Kung
Seal
Fu
died?
They put up pictures of Seal and Heidi Klum while talking about Michael Clark Duncan.
You work your whole life. You fucking you outshine Tom Hanks in one movie and yeah, shit. Yeah. When you pass, they're like, there goes Seal.
Yep. Apparently they thought Seal had passed away.
Bummer, man.
Statement posted on the website of WGRZ in Buffalo reads, yep, our bad. We own it. A careless editing error at the end of our Michael Clark Duncan story on our 11 o'clock news. Two entertainment stories accidentally merged into one video clip. Sincere apologies, they said. Give him the double tap. They added, but seriously, black guys really look alike.
Oh!
Which I thought was really inappropriate. I thought they should have quit while they were ahead. They didn't really write that, though. Once in a while, celebrities can get out of their own egos, get out of their own ways, and do something nice for somebody else. When that happens, we like to celebrate it. It's called Hollywood Helper.
Ooh-ah, ooh-ah.
More margaritas.
Ooh-ah, ooh-ah.
Hollywood Helper. Hollywood Helper.
No, you don't get to do it twice.
Helper. Come on now.
Hollywood Helper.
You don't get to lick your own nipples twice in the show.
Go ahead.
We want to thank our own Hollywood Helper. I wish I knew this cat's name. Maybe he'll let me know. But apparently he's on Twitter at HBO Helper. This guy has started hollywoodhelper.blogspot.com, and he is going through every single Hollywood Babylon, and he is breaking it down into what we covered and at what time, so you can go right to it. He's breaking down every episode of the show we do for people who want to know more about the
Amazing.
Show.
Amazing.
So he is, he's got way too much fucking time on his hands.
That's his Twitter handle, is HBO Helper.
HBO Helper, at HBO Helper, yeah. So if you want to follow him, I think he's up to episode 10 right now. He's got a lot of work ahead of him. But he has dedicated himself to breaking down our show minute by minute. I know, right? Hollywood Helper, this week, has a theme. I call it World's Finest. Because the two Hollywood Helpers this week are Superman and Batman.
Yeah!
Let's start with Superman. Dean Cain was at DragonCon last week. That was Atlanta, right? Isn't that the big con in Atlanta?
Yes, big con.
And apparently there is a gentleman there who's dressed as Adam West's Batman, and his girlfriend was dressed as Yvonne Craig, Batgirl.
Okay.
And this guy got to Dean Cain, and they were doing some big photo shoot or whatever, and he slipped him in the engagement ring that he wanted to give his girlfriend. And Dean Cain brought the two of them out of the crowd and was able to facilitate the proposal between the Adam West Batman and the Yvonne Craig Batgirl.
Very sweet.
I brought you a little footage. You'll see Dean Cain here making it happen. Here's the guys from Dragon Con proposing to each other.
Will you marry me?
Yeah!
I got so hard watching Batgirl kiss Batman. You have no idea.
I dreamed of that when I was a kid, man.
I have spanked it to that video about 18 times since I first got her.
That was pretty. That took me full circle. I was suddenly 5 years old again going,
How
I
long
knew
did
it.
We wait for that?
I knew it. Yeah. So They're thanks. In love.
Thanks to listener James who sent
Robin
that.
Robin is their baby. That's what my mother was like, no more for you.
Robin's so jealous. And Christian Bale, what a guy. He's pretty strong. There was a kid in Youngstown, Ohio, by the name of Jaden Barber, five-year-old Jaden Barber. The entire city got together and organized a Facebook page called Lighting the Bat Signal for Jaden. And 30,000 volunteers in that town got together to try to make his dream come true. Five-year-old Jaden Barber has been diagnosed with MSD leukemia and had been given only months to live. His dream was to meet Batman. He wanted to meet Christian Bale. And so they posted this on Facebook, tried to get as much publicity for it as possible. Well, the good news is last week, Christian Bale caught wind of it and flew Jaden and his family here to Los Angeles and treated them to a lunch and a day at Disneyland and took them to lunch at Disney's Club 33.
That's amazing. That's awesome.
Here's a picture of Christian Bale and Jaden. He was going through treatment, but Bale went out of his way to make it happen. And
do you think Jaden was like, where's the fucking outfit, buddy?
Yeah.
I said Batman.
Not 8 years off goatee Bruce Wayne.
I don't want emo Bruce. I want Batman.
I want that guy.
Start barking.
I don't want crippled fucking Kane shooting arrows in your bedroom, Bruce Wayne. I want good fucking Batman.
That's so
Christian
fucking...
Bale punched him right in the face. It's so sad. That's why his face looks a little swollen in that photo. What? I'm telling you what happened. I'm here to report the news.
Oh.
If you people can't take it, you might as well just leave. Because I tell the truth here.
I might go with them on that one. Oh, Lord.
All right, I'm going to get you back because I got some good news.
He made him Robin. That would be adorable.
Christian Bale left town and just let him walk through a waterfall on his own and just take over for
him. No, not movie Robin. He put like the Robin out. That would have been amazing. I'm like, look, this is cool. I ain't taking anything away. What he did is amazing. Just take it 1% further, man. Dress up like Batman. Dress the kid up like Robin.
Look, I'm on your side.
That kid's mind would fucking explode, as would mine.
Yeah.
Still, this is fucking fantastic.
It was fantastic. The only thing that could make this news better actually happened this week. Jaden has beat the odds, and his doctors have announced he's now in remission.
The fuck out of here, really?
Yeah. They went from giving him months to live to finding out that his body has recovered and he's actually in remission. He is cancer-free right now.
You're gonna make me cry, man.
So it's a miracle. It's a great story all the way around.
See, the Batman has the fucking healing power, man.
Yes.
Batman is a saint.
Apparently, Christian Bale put a brace on his knee and everything was fucking fine after that. That's what happened.
Now you can make the joke about the kid getting beat in the face because everything works
out
for
him. I knew I'd get you
him.
Back
yeah,
at the
you
end.
Did, yeah. Stick with Ralph.
Christian Bale told the family he wants the money back, however, that he spent to get them out there. Since Jaden's not going to die, he said he'd like to be reimbursed for the trip. So it's kind of tacky, I thought.
Do you know how fucking expensive Club
33
is?
Oh, good for you. You're going to live. I want my money back.
He's off the hook now for that, right?
Who, Bale?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Big
yeah.
time. Like yeah. When he went to, remember he went to Colorado?
Yeah, after Aurora.
That took him definitely off the hook, but this really fucking takes him off the hook.
Well, did you know he called in to my radio show
yeah.
after the thing? I mean, he was the on only K-Rock. Media outlet he talked to.
Why you guys?
Because I think we were relentlessly mocking him for weeks. I would do a bit on the radio where I would call in as Christian Bale, and they would say, Christian, good morning, how are you doing? You know, things are good here. Oh, good for you! And I would just scream at Kevin and Bean on the radio. And apparently he was in town and heard it and actually laughed. He thought that was funny. So when he decided to make his apology, he called our station. And it was so funny because he called in on the listener request line. It's like, yeah, this is Christian Bale. I'd like to go on the air and talk about what happened. We're like, yeah, sure. You're Christian Bale. Douchebag already. Click. But it really was him. And he went out and said, look, I was way out of line, and it was a bad day, and I apologize, and I shouldn't behave that way. I should be more professional. And he actually won me over just that day.
Class move. I remember that. Call.
And then he's visiting people in Aurora, and he's healing the sick. There's nothing this fucking guy can't do.
Oh, he is Bat Christ.
He is. Every week we take a look at things in movies and you all right?
Yeah.
You're looking around like I thought the Phantom of the Opera was going to drop the chandelier on us or something. I need your attention.
Surveying the room.
I ask is your attention.
You have it, but I was literally surveying the room, and I was like, okay, Ralph's about to finish the intro. And then you like stopped it short to be like, don't look around, look at me.
No more wire hangers.
Yeah, eyes here. Same way in the back room before he gets on stage. In the bathroom, downward tug. He's like, look here.
Stop that.
Look, don't look away.
Oh, good for you. Every week we look at moments in TV and film that we can't imagine. All the people involved with these projects that someone didn't say, you know what? That shit should just... Planet
of the Apes?
That was my Cornelius good man.
Yeah. Oh, my God. You won't be happy, Dr. Zayas.
Finish the intro.
It is a segment we call Shit That Should Not Be.
And now for shit we should not see. Here's some shit that should not be.
Usually shit that should not be is mistakes that are made in production. Sometimes, though, they do shit on purpose that should not be. And that is the case this week. Both the shit that should not be and exquisite acting this week, they have a theme. It's a Star Trek-based theme. I don't know if we have any Trekkers in the audience or not, but we're going to start off with Star Trek The Next Generation. This is from an episode called Conspiracy. And I'm going to show you some audio and show you some video, rather. And as you watch the video, ignore what they're talking about. It's really pointless. But once Riker and Picard, Jean-Luc Picard, once they clear the scene,
you're good.
Thanks. It's basically a more coherent Connery. That's what Jean-Luc Picard is.
Is it?
Yeah. Because Connery's down here and he's a fucking asshole, and Jean-Luc Picard's up here and he's much more serious. Picard and Riker clear the scene. You'll go, what the fuck? So here's a shot from Star Trek: The Next Generation.
When you've finished showing the Admiral anything that he needs, you can join me down on Earth.
I may want to stay a while, Jean-Luc.
Of course. Stay as long as you wish. No.
What's this? That ensign either has no pants on or he's wearing a skirt. It's a bare-legged fucking crewman on the Enterprise. What kind of ship are you running, Jean-Luc?
Maybe it's Scotty.
It wasn't a kilt. It was like a long shirt. That guy had his balls hanging out. Why is the guy in Star Trek wearing a skirt? Is that the future? I don't want any part of it. I don't want to walk around with my balls dangling on the hallways of the Enterprise.
Maybe the dude's layering up. It's his version of a hockey jersey in the future and shit.
Well, put some fucking pants on. Picard's got pants on. Riker's got pants on. This guy's working on the fucking warp drive with his balls hanging out. That shit should not be.
In the Enterprise, great when our dicks are out. They're like, no. Who said you could do this?
Anything goes on the Enterprise now. Guys blowing each other in the holodeck, anything.
Check out my hollow dick.
Fuck you. Oh, he just filed that joke. As we continue with our Star Trek theme in this week's Exquisite Acting.
To be or not to be, that is the question.
Welcome to the world of Exquisite Acting with Ralph Garman and Kevin Smith.
This week's Exquisite Acting, and I can't believe we haven't featured him before, is the legendary William Shatner, who, of course, played Captain James Tiberius Kirk in the original series. This moment, we're pulling from an episode called The Enemy Within. If you remember this episode, this is where the transporter... You could say the transformer malfunctions. Like, Optimus Prime's all fucked up on the Enterprise.
Fucking Shia LaBeouf is there as well. Sam Witwicky and shit.
The transporter malfunctions.
Yes.
And they're beaming Captain Kirk up from the surface of some planet where I guarantee you he just fucks some hot alien. But they beam him up and he gets split into two halves. His good, mellow, righteous half and his more aggressive, evil half.
Okay.
And the evil half believes he's the true Captain Kirk, and the pussy half thinks he's Captain Kirk, and so they have to hunt down evil Kirk on the Enterprise. This is a scene where evil Kirk hears good Kirk talking over the intercom on the Enterprise and loses his shit. It is a sequence I like to call I'm Captain Kirk, and you'll understand why as we watch the exquisite acting of William Shatner.
The imposter is not to be injured. Use minimum force. Repeat, the imposter is not to be injured.
I'm Captain Kirk. I'm Captain Kirk. I'm Captain Kirk!
You can tell he's evil because he's screaming through his teeth. I'm Captain Kirk! Evil guys don't live. My new favorite game we play here at Hollywood Babylon is a game where we take Kevin and we stick him in places he doesn't belong. It's a game called Kev In.
What's Kev In today? Something crazy or awesome or gay. And by gay we mean homosexual, like maybe some dudes, but what's Kev In?
What's Kev In this week? By the way, if you want to see all of the Kevin submissions, you can go to thekevingame.tumblr.com.
God, everybody's got a fucking Tumblr.
People
for this
like
show.
To ride our coattails, God bless them, and they do a lot of work that we don't want to do.
Thank
so it
you.
All
I
works
appreciate
out.
It. Yes.
This week, we've got Kevins in movies, in television, and in politics. Let's start off with the first Kevin, shall we? This is Doctor Who, Kevin. This is Kevin versus the Daleks. And you can see the slogan underneath is robotic immunity. You make a good-looking Doctor Who, by the way.
I could do it, man. I could be a Time Lord.
It's pretty strong.
The last Time Lord. The only fucking Time Lord.
You could be the good Time Lord.
Totally,
yeah.
Man. The one that's like, how come he never comes out of the TARDIS?
You open up and a big
door.
Billowing cloud of smoke comes out. It's like Cheech and Chong's Doctor Who.
Doctor what?
So weird.
Doctor What and the Gay Ghost.
Now that's a series.
Come on, man.
In keeping with our brand new t-shirt, here's Ghostbusters Kevin. Here's the Ghostbusters taking on Kevin. It's right there, the Stay Puff Marshmallow Kev.
Oh, I got called that so many times in high school.
Oh, sorry, I didn't mean to bring back any
bad
memories.
It wasn't bad. I enjoyed Stay Puffed.
And lastly, this answers a question I've had for some time regarding what happened at the Republican National Convention. Can we see this? Now I know who Clint Eastwood was talking to. It was our own Kevin sitting in the chair. We just didn't recognize it at the time. You're paying no attention to Eastwood, by the way.
No, man.
That's so rude.
Well, the shit he was saying was weird.
No, I can't do that to myself. Yeah.
Poor addle-brained old Clint Eastwood.
He's not the only one, dude. I saw Chuck Norris recently.
Oh, we're going to be talking
you
about
haven't?
That in
all
the
right,
Hollywood.
Fair enough. Fair
in the,
enough.
This week's entertainment news headlines, or as we like to call them, the HBO headlines.
Give me headlines.
Let's get to the breaking news before we hit politics and show business. This morning, Miley Cyrus's home was invaded by an intruder.
This is fucked up. No.
Sadly, she wasn't there. I'm sorry.
Oh, stop it.
An intruder was arrested at her home. He jumped the fence surrounding her home. He was armed with a pair of scissors, say law enforcement. Which is kind of scary.
That's enough to do something. That's enough to do some damage.
Cops responded to a 911 call from her home. Wasn't placed by Miley. As I mentioned, she wasn't home. But when they captured Jason Luis Rivera, he was arrested for trespassing, and they did find him armed with scissors. This is the second time this month Miley Cyrus has been attacked with scissors. This is the first time. Yeah. That first guy did enough fucking damage. I don't know what the other guy was thinking. He was trying to fix it. Yeah. He was a hairstylist who said, seriously, have you seen her? I couldn't help myself. I jumped the fence. It's an emergency. I just have to fix those bangs. Shay shit.
She's trying to have the best of both worlds.
Seriously. Bieber's got better hair. And that's saying something. More criminal celebrity news. Amanda Bynes from What I Like About You and Nickelodeon. Well, hey, you say that like it's a bad thing, fucker.
Dude just yells out, she's a drunk.
I take offense to that. She has officially been charged by L.A. County for two misdemeanor counts of hit and run after two separate incidents in April and August. She will fuck you up in months beginning with A. She's going to be arraigned on September the 27th. If she's convicted on both counts, she could spend a year behind bars.
She'll never do
not
time.
Not the kind of bar she's usually behind. The DMV also suspended her license. So we're all a little safer on the way home tonight. That's all I'm telling you. What I like about you is that you can't hold your liquor, apparently. Kevin, you're going to be very upset about this. Kay. Starsky's in trouble. Paul Micah Glazer, who... Or Paul... Sorry. I sobered up for a minute.
Paul Micah Glazer.
Dick Clark stopped by.
Paul Micah Glazer. It's in Times Square with Ryan Seacrest. Why?
Paul Michael Glazer, who played David Starsky in the legendary 70s TV series Starsky and Hutch,
yes,
got busted in Kentucky, of all places, with marijuana and a pipe. Paul said, but I'm from California.
Did he try to use that?
He said, I am. This is medicinal marijuana. I have a card, you know, and this is, for me, it's legal.
I got to know how this turns out, because I've been waiting to use this excuse everywhere.
Yeah. The Kentucky police said, that don't work here, Jew boy.
Wow. Is that verbatim?
He said. he apparently was there reading an excerpt from his young adult novel, Crystallia and the Source of Light.
No, come on. He's writing fucking young adult novels. Let him smoke his weed, man.
He said the prescription was prescribed to him in California, and they said apparently an anonymous phone call to the police said a man was smoking marijuana in the hotel, and that's why the Kentucky police showed up.
Can't do that.
Yeah.
Can't do that sort of thing, man. If you're going to smoke, especially like outside of California, I've found, you got to go way the fuck away from where anybody is. Because yeah. It's true. When you live out here, you get very accustomed to just like, hey, it's California, man. You literally walk up to police and be like, what's up? Want some?
I'm pretty sure that's not true.
Maybe not that far. We're not there yet, but yeah. Almost yeah. And shit. But then you get used to smoking wherever you, like every once in a while. My wife would be like, bring the garbage cans in. But I'm like, I'm smoking. She's like, do both. I'm like, yeah. So I'll go out with a fucking joint and start moving the garbage cans in because there's three, so it takes a long time.
Sure.
And I'm
smoking. That's like 3.5 joints for you.
But by the time I'm done, like, you know, I've combined the two, and I realize as the garage door closes, like, any place else, man, like, I'd be like, oh, shit. Like, I'd be afraid, but in Los Angeles, not at all.
You also realize when the garage door closes that you still left the cans outside. You thought you were bringing them in, but you really hadn't.
Oh, I brought in the neighbor's garbage cans all the way down the block.
And the DA is going to be outside your house with guns trained on you.
I'm like, what, do you think I got weed? They're like, bring us the garbage cans. Stop stealing them. It's a federal offense.
All right, let's talk about politics and celebrity crossing paths.
Ugh, remind me never to fucking say anything about politics, man.
This is particularly bad because we're leading up to an election. We're just weeks away from an election, and both sides are getting chatty. Hank Williams Jr. is at it again. What a surprise. He, I think, I'm not sure, is not an Obama fan. I can't be sure. Let me read his comments he made Sunday at the Stockyards Music Festival in Dallas, Texas.
That's where you want to make your biggest statements.
Here's the quote. We got a Muslim for a president who hates cowboys, hates cowgirls, hates fishing, hates farming, loves gays, and we hate him. Sadly, a rousing cheer came up from the crowd in Texas. Reportedly, he said the same sort of thing at a late August concert in Virginia, I believe it was, but he added the homosexual slam to this particular lineup, which is good. He's mixing it up, which is nice. He's giving the fans something fresh on the stage, which I think is strong.
Is it possible to love gays and farming and fishing as well?
I don't think so. I think they're mutually exclusive. I like to think that Hank Williams
Mountain,
Jr.
Brokeback Mountain.
That's
those
true.
Dudes,
they were farmers. Yeah. They were ranchers.
Well, they were fishing. They were fishing,
they
all right.
Fishing.
Fishing for a dick. And
oh, come on.
Credits.
They're fishing for the leather Cheerio.
Yeah.
I like to think after Williams made those comments, he went into the wings of the stage and just blew a stagehand. I like to think he's just really, really deep in the closet.
On
and
the
he's, just, he's a self-loathing gay guy, and he just...
Sadly, I think that's who he is.
Yeah. Romney got a weird endorsement this week from an unexpected source. Nicki Minaj, of all people.
Was it Nicki Minaj or her alternate personality?
Well, they're not sure. She was rapping on a brand new Lil Wayne song from a new release called Dedication 4, where she raps on the song. Here is a little piece of the audio. This is the quote from that rap that has everyone talking.
I'm a Republican voting for Mitt Romney. You lazy bitches is fucking up the economy.
All right, first of all, I object to the rhyme Romney and economy.
I was there, man. I like it. It's fresh and chilly most.
Now, people are arguing, is she really saying that the poor are fucking up the economy? Or is she parodying Republicans and trying to present a character?
Like in a quote or something
like that.
In a quote,
as if she is portraying a Republican.
Right.
She's not smart enough for that, ma'am. You're absolutely right. Or is she just looking for publicity? And if that's the case, then she actually got it.
Okay. Now, they haven't figured that out. They don't know which it is.
She won't comment on it, and Lil Wayne won't comment on it.
She's being mysterious.
She's being mysterious, yes.
Interesting.
Yeah. She is being subtle for a change, as opposed to her giant bleach blonde wig and her ass padding or whatever else she has going on. And speaking of ass padding, Chuck Norris is in the news. He and his spooky, crazy Christian wife, Gina, have released a YouTube video begging evangelical Christians to register to vote because they claim if you don't, we are headed not only for socialism, but something much worse.
Give them the figure.
Apparently, they say 30 million evangelical Christians failed to vote in 2008, right. And that's why Barack Obama won the presidency by 10 million votes.
Right. That's not the figure I'm talking about, man.
Oh, okay. I brought in the video if you want to watch it yourself. This is Chuck Norris talks about the fact that we're headed for socialism or much worse. His crazy Stepford wife, Gina, says, if you don't vote for Mitt Romney, shit's going to go down. Worse than you could possibly imagine.
We will preserve for our children this last best hope for man on earth, or we will sentence them to take the first step into 1,000 years of darkness.
If you vote for Barack Obama, we are headed into 1,000 years of darkness.
There will be an ancient shogun, 1,000 years old, and only Chuck will be able to beat him. Isn't that right, Chuck? And Chuck just looks in the camera. He's like, what can I say, man? I like sex.
Yeah. She's much younger than me, and she's a crazy fucking Christian.
Oh, my God, man.
Now, here's the thing. That line, 1,000 years of darkness, was pulled from a Ronald Reagan speech that he made in 1964. He made it on behalf of the candidate for the Republicans, Barry Goldwater, who was running against Lyndon Baines Johnson, who lost by the largest margin in history. So if you're going to use that in a political way, you may want to rethink your quotes.
Yeah.
Plus, if really they're all about praying to Jesus, and I have no problem with that if that's what you choose to do.
Jesus rocks.
He and his wife, Chuck and his wife, should pray for a better hairpiece for Chuck Norris. That really should be the priority.
He's just sticking with
what works.
Because
dude's wearing a womp rat on his head.
I know, but it's like it almost looks like he went to a Halloween store and bought a Chuck Norris wig.
More politics and celebrities crossing paths. Lindsay Lohan in the news this week.
Lindsay Lohan, why don't you come to your senses?
Oh, Lindsay. Barack Obama this week tweeted, I've cut taxes for those who need it, middle-class families and small businesses. Lohan immediately retweeted the president and then added her own tweet. I've got a still store of it here if you want to take a look at it. It says, Barack Obama, we also need to cut taxes for those who are listed on Forbes as millionaires, but if they are not, you must consider that as well. Apparently, Lindsay was on a list of millionaires from Forbes magazine, and she claims she's not, so she wants a tax cut. It may be the most specific tax cut in the history of politics. She's asking Barack Obama to give her a tax cut. Anyone who Forbes magazine says is a millionaire who really isn't a millionaire needs a tax cut.
So she's saying she's on the list, but she doesn't really have that much money.
Yes.
What a weird tweet to throw out there. If you're that's your like your first fucking statement to the president, you're like, can I be exempt because I don't have a lot of money?
They say I do, but I really don't.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Lindsay also asked in a later tweet that any stolen diamonds be considered tax exempt. So, I wish her well. In legal news, Ben and Jerry's Ice Cream has filed a suit. You don't even know what the fuck I'm talking about, and you're cheering. You just love Ben and Jerry's ice cream, don't
just
you?
Just like ice cream.
Just any mention of Ben and Jerry's. You're like, yeah! Chunky monkey! Ben and Jerry's is suing two porn companies, Rodax Video and Caballero Video, because apparently they have run out of movies and TV shows to parody, so now they're parodying Ben and Jerry's flavors. Porn movies based on the flavors of Ben and Jerry.
No.
Yes. They've taken Cherry Garcia and they've changed it into Harry Garcia for folks who like their women au natural.
Okay.
They've taken American Dream.
Yeah, American Cream.
American Cream. That's what they've made it to, sir. Apparently, you're a fan of the work of these two companies. What I thought was their biggest challenge, Boston Cream Pie, which already is a porn title, was changed to Boston Cream Thigh.
That's weak. That doesn't make me horny at all.
Other flavors, Chocolate Fudge Babes.
Oh, that makes me horny.
No. I don't want to know where the chocolate fudge is coming from in this video. Peanut Butter D Cups.
Leather Cheerios. Adorable.
Peanut Butter D Cups, New York Fat and Chunky are other ones.
My nickname in high school was New Jersey Fat and Chunky.
Was it really? They are suing them for smearing their their good name and reputation is considered it's being smeared, if you will.
That's strange to me, man. I don't know if that's possible to sue for that sort of thing. Do they show it as ice cream?
Like, I think it's like a fake pint on the cover with the name on it, as if it's, you know, it's a reference to
so
that.
So if anything, they have to change the look of maybe the ice cream pint on the cover or something. But you can't stop somebody from calling a fucking porno Harry Garcia.
That's what I'm thinking.
I mean, because what's next? First you attack porn, then you're going after Mad Magazine?
Right. I want to know, first of all, where's Cocky Road? I want to know where that is. Where's Chocolate Jizz Mint? I want to know where that is.
They had an ice cream recently that I fell in love with that was called Cluster Fluff.
Oh.
And it's fantastic.
You don't need to change that at all.
If you've never had it, number one, eat it.
Yeah.
But just leave the rest of the day because you'll go on a sugar high and a sugar crash and sleep for 12 hours. That's what happens to me. That's how I sleep at night. It is fucking amazing. But there was some outcry because it was called Cluster Fluff. And they had to change the fucking name to What a Cluster.
Oh, no.
Which fucking blew, because Cluster Fluff was awesome. Like, right away, as you were buying it, you were like, Cluster Fluff.
Cluster Fuck.
Totally, yeah. You felt a little
I'm
dirty.
A rebel, and I'm going to get really sleepy.
But, yeah, that was Cluster Fluff. They had to change, man. So maybe they're feeling a little, you know, fucking... We had to change our title.
Where's Chocolate Chip Cookie Blow? Where's that one?
Oh, my God.
Where's Chubby Hubby? Yeah.
Right
or
here.
Hubby's Chubby. That's all I have to do is flip it.
Chubby Hubby's sitting right next to you. What am I if not your Chubby Hubby?
You are my Chubby Hubby.
Thanks. I actually blushed.
It's a love connection. We'll be back in 2 and 2. While we're talking about porn... Porn star Kim Kardashian's in the news this week.
Kim Kardashian, Kim Kardashian, who gives a fuck?
Porn star Kim Kardashian was in New York City this week promoting her True Reflection perfume.
Who cares?
Well, it turns out she caught a private jet to Charlotte, North Carolina, where they were having the Democratic National Convention, and she had a personal appearance at a nightclub there. To promote her own brand, of course, and also to celebrate the DNC. And when she got there, 50 people turned up to the club.
Which one is this?
She went to Charlotte, North Carolina, which is filled at this point with horny Democrats.
And only 50 people showed up to the nightclub where she was making an appearance.
And this is Kim, the fucking Kim. The leader of the Kardashians.
This is the head of the Kardashian cock, if you will.
And only 50?
Only 50 people showed up, which leads to people to speculate, are Americans tiring of the Kardashians?
That's a good sign, man. I was on the road somewhere. We did a show. I forget where it was. I want to say it's in Texas. And I think it was it Babel or was it Jay and Bob Get Old? But we had followed, not her, but the other one.
Well, there's a couple of them.
I don't know.
There's Chloe.
I think it was the one that's not the chewy one. Who's the other one?
Courtney.
Maybe her. She did one of these appearances, like, at the same place where we were doing a show. She was previously, like, maybe two nights prior or a week prior. And there's no show. She just shows up.
Right.
And it's open, and you pay a lot of money to be in the club at the same time as her.
Right.
The guy reported that, he was telling us, not reported, he literally told us, and he was the owner of the club, so I had to fucking believe him. But they paid a substantial amount of money for her to come. She showed up for about 35 minutes. She signed like three things and then you fucking left. Off. And it was a chunk of change, dude. It was like upwards of 40K and shit. I was like, no. And he said that like they had to reimburse everybody's money because people who paid for the event were like, what the fuck? She just left. So that club was out of some fucking loot and whatnot. But he said that the long story short though, he said the turnout wasn't that fucking huge.
Well, it wasn't 50.
No, that's fine. And it's even weirder because she's like the most well-known. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wow, man. Things are looking up.
She left after 2 hours. Apparently, she stormed out furious because one of the guys in the house band said, this fucking place is empty. And she got all chapped-assed about it and left in a huff. She immediately hopped on a black cock and felt much better afterwards. And got pregnant. No, she didn't. Russell Crowe was in the news this week. You know, he's playing Noah in the new movie Noah, about Noah's Ark. He plays Noah in the biblical epic Noah.
Okay.
And in order to get used to, I guess, what it's like to be in a boat, he went kayaking in the Atlantic Ocean this week.
Which is very much like an ark.
Very much. Only instead of two of everything, you've got one of you, basically. He and a friend went kayaking off the coast of Long Island Sound last Saturday and couldn't find their way back. The Coast Guard had to tow them in.
Off of Long Island?
Yes.
We can't find New York!
The guy in charge of the rescue operation said they got a little bit lost. Now, Russell Crowe denies that happened. Via Twitter, he said they ran out of daylight. It got dark, and that's why they got confused. He said it was a grand adventure. He was really happy about how it turned out.
Right on.
Those who know the hot-headed actor, though, say he was so angry he punched the ocean in the face. So I don't buy that for a moment. While we're talking about movie stars, Tom...
Oh, hold on. Do it again. One more time. This is him punching the ocean.
While we're talking about movie stars, Tom Cruise is featured in the upcoming Vanity Fair magazine. They talk about the fact before he married Katie Holmes, Scientology had an internal audition process to find him his next wife. Now, this had been rumored for some time, but this person who wrote the article said they have actual proof from a guy who was running the Scientology's in-house video studio who recorded the audition tapes for these girls. The winner, if you consider it winning... of the audition was an Iranian-born actress who was part of Scientology named Nazanin Boniadi. Boniadi. She was put through a Scientology auditing process for a very important mission for a month. Tom Cruise be with a woman. Mission impossible. And... They told him initially, you're auditioning for a training film for Scientology.
Yeah.
And it turned out to be the next Mrs. Cruise. That's what the actual auditions were. They went through a ton of Scientology-based actresses. They found this woman. She was picked. They started dating. Her and Tom Cruise actually started dating, and they split up after 3 months. She did not get the mission accomplished.
Right on.
And so, according to the story, she was forced to clean toilets with a toothbrush and dig ditches in the middle of the night as punishment for failing her mission.
To make Tom Cruise straight?
No, because Tom rejected her. She was not the right
choice. And she got punished for that?
Yes.
Oh, my God, man. Thank God. Like, you know how many fucking toilets I'd be scrubbing if I was punished for every time I got turned down?
I know. It's not her fault.
Jesus. I've heard from people who were on that list and vetted.
Oh, really?
Yeah, like, there were apparently a few names and one
Jason
person.
Jason Mewes? No. Jason Mewes, one of them?
No, but it was a pretty high-profile actress, and she told me the story. My fucking head spun.
Come on, say who it is.
I'll tell you after the show. I can't. No, I can't, man. I can't. I cannot. I'll get fucking killed. Yeah.
Was it Betty White?
Close.
Just not if it was Betty White.
B Dub. No, but it was. There was a. Would you like to meet? Would you like to chill out?
What do you think of Tom Cruise? Isn't he the best?
It was weird when it was explained. I was like, you sure you didn't misread that? And they were like, let me explain it again and add more detail. And the more they went on, it was just like, holy Christ, like you were literally being shopped.
Wow.
Like,
it's like a slave auction.
But then a few not too long after that, suddenly Katie Holmes.
You unlock this door with the key of another.
Twilight Zone.
Yeah, a little bit.
While we're talking about creepy sex and actors, Al Pacino has been tapped to play Joe Paterno in a movie about Penn State.
Who are they doing it for?
Ooh-ah. Oh. I don't know. But my thought is, don't fuck kids! Come on now! With the showering, with kids, ooh-ah. Jerry Sandusky has a great ass. Ooh-ah. Oh. Fight on, Nittany Lions. Ooh-ah.
He is going to play Paterno in a movie about the whole controversy.
That sounds more like a HBO movie than anything else.
They don't know whether it's going to be a TV movie or a feature film, but let's throw a little up. Throw a picture of Joe and Al next to each other. I can see it.
Yeah,
I can see it.
He played Kevorkian, so why not?
Actually, Kevorkian looks a lot like Paterno, really, when you think about it.
Especially now. Too fucking soon?
Ooh-ah.
While we're talking about movies, let's talk about some movies that we know for sure are guaranteed to suck.
Bruckheimer, Schumacher, Michael Bay, they make movies that make you say, oh my God, that's bullshit, what the fuck? They're movies that will suck.
Luke Wilson has announced he's going to star in an upcoming sports movie called Million Dollar Man. It's the story of a truck driver who's given a second chance in life as a football kicker. First of all, not an original idea.
I was going to say, this sounds like that Philadelphia Eagles movie.
This sounds a lot
Mark
like
Wahlberg.
The garbage-picking, field goal-kicking Philadelphia phenomenon.
Is this a real story?
No. But it was a TV movie made about a Philadelphia garbage man who used to kick the lever on his truck, and he developed his leg muscles so much that the Philadelphia Eagles asked him to kick field goals for him. Tony Danza starred as the garbage man.
But this was a fictional story.
It was.
Okay.
This is also a fictional story. Only it doesn't have the charisma of Tony Danza involved. It's got Luke Wilson and Emmanuel Shariki from Entourage. And this is going to be in a theater near you, motherfucker.
Stop threatening me with your art.
It's going to suck.
I don't know who that. Who is Emmanuel?
She played E's girlfriend in Entourage. Did you? Sloan.
Sloan.
Yeah. Did you watch Entourage?
I remember Sloan.
Yes.
She's pretty.
She's very pretty, but this movie will suck. And here's a movie that will suck, and we know it'll suck because they've already shown us the trailer. Warner Brothers has announced a sequel to A Christmas Story. If you're a fan of maybe the greatest Christmas movie ever, about little Ralphie looking for his Red Ryder BB gun from his dad, Darren McGavin, they have decided they're going to do a direct-to-DVD sequel of A Christmas Story, where Ralphie's all grown up, and instead of a toy, he wants a car. And his little brother Randy's now older, and basically what they do is they shit all over Christmas. They rape Santa's ass. I'm so angry about this, and I want to protect you from this film so much that I brought in the trailer for you to take a look at.
What? There's a trailer? It's done?
Here's the online trailer for the movie coming out this Christmas, A Christmas Story 2, the official sequel.
This is for you from Aunt Clara. That is too adorable for words.
I can think of a few.
A Christmas Story 2, the official sequel.
Isn't it beautiful?
It's risen from the grave.
This is the greatest Christmas in history.
Own it on Blu-ray combo pack or download to own. DVD 2-pack also available.
You can buy it on DVD, you can get it on Blu-ray, or you can just open a fucking vein in a warm bath. Those are your options.
Oh,
thank
man.
Thank God Darren McGavin's dead.
But it's like, the source material for A Christmas Story was the Gene Shepard essays.
Right.
I don't know if you've ever read them. Gene Shepard was a wonderful writer. In fact, the kind of writing I like to do when I do personal essays, if you read Tough Shit at all, that comes from the style of Gene Shepard. It's where I learned to kind of write personal type stuff where you can kind of throw in humor but still make it nostalgic even though you're not that old. He wrote these, but he was old when he wrote his books.
Yeah.
He wrote these wonderful stories of youth that are very much just like A Christmas Story. In fact, Gene Shepard, the author, is the guy who narrates A Christmas Story. That's his voice. If you ever get a chance, you know, I know a lot of people aren't big readers anymore, but there's a book that he wrote called In God We Trust, All Others Pay Cash. It is a fantastic, funny book. That's where most of the Christmas story comes from. They also pulled from other stories within the book a little bit. But what we just saw and what you described has no bearing or connection to the material. Like,
no.
There are a wealth of stories. Ralphie, well, I mean, in the movie, he's called Ralphie, but that character continued to grow up, and he took him into adolescence and wrote stories about it, because he was essentially Ralphie, Gene Shepard was. So they have a bunch of shit they could pull from, but instead they're just like...
They're repeating the same jokes from the first
pretty
movie.
Pretty much. Like,
they got the lamp
the
with the leg,
lamp.
And they make the kid wear a bad costume, and it's just, it's horrific on every level.
It is kind of a bummer.
So Hollywood, fuck you, is what we're saying, basically.
You know what? Not fuck Hollywood. Just to combat that, go out and read In God We Trust, All Others Pay Cash, man. Pick up, throw a little money toward the estate of Gene Shepard. If you love A Christmas Story, you love that guy. He originated all that stuff.
New TV news, J.J. Abrams is working on a new series.
Jesus Christ. This dude never fucking stops,
hey,
man.
He's got a mortgage.
I got a mortgage too, but like,
well, then
I just
get
sit
to
around
work.
And smoke weed all day. This motherfucker, like... Constantly, you turn around, he's just like, oh, I just fucking pooped out a new show.
He's got a new series for Fox on the way.
Unbelievable.
He's working with his fellow Fringe mastermind, J.H. Wyman. Two guys. I love that Fringe, by the way. I don't know if you guys watch Fringe or not, but I love that show. J.J. and Wyman are working together on a new show about the LAPD in the near future, where every human cop is teamed up with a robot cop.
Ooh, I like that.
Yeah. It's an android cop and a human cop, and they battle crime in LAPD together, which I think is pretty fucking awesome.
Yeah, yeah.
And it sounds very original.
No.
Not. I guess we're all forgetting about the classic 1977 series Future Cop with Ernest Borgnine. Oh,
yeah. And a robot.
No one's ever heard of that. I don't think it lasted longer than two episodes. But I'm just telling you, same fucking premise. Want me to prove it to you? Here's the opening credits to Future Cop. How about that?
Now, this good-looking kid on my right, a rookie cop called Haven, he's the secret. He looks human, talks and acts human, but he's not. He's an android, a robot, the perfect cop, the cop of the future, a future cop.
Ta-da! There is a 61% probability, therefore, the location is Santa Monica Municipal.
How could he know all of that?
That's the best white boy I ever seen.
Yeah, I know.
Future Cop. Yeah,
why can't you know all that?
Best part is the John Amos racism from the 70s. How can he know all that? That's the fastest white boy I've ever seen.
Oh, shit.
I miss racism.
Why can you know all that, Ralph?
And in music news, Lana Del Rey is catching a lot of shit this week because she did a naked photo layout for GQ magazine in the UK. Here's a photo of her, one of her photos from the spread in GQ magazine. Yeah. A lot of music websites are saying she can no longer be taken seriously because of this.
Why?
Because she's posing in the nude, and she's an artist, and you shouldn't do that. You shouldn't make it about the sex. You should make it about the music.
Madonna took her clothes off a bunch. She did a whole book where she was like, look at me with fucking shit on my nipples. I love sex.
Yeah. But Lana Del Rey's like an indie artist, and she's like a hipster artist, and they're saying she's not being true to the form.
Amanda Palmer is a fucking indie hipster artist, and I don't think I've seen anything more erotic than she got a fucking clip up right now online. What was that song called? The First Time Ever I Saw Your Face? It's right. Her and the Flaming Lips covering it,
yeah.
And she's naked in a bathtub. Now, I'll just warn you before you go, because a bunch of people listen, like, I'm going to find this and jerk off.
Yeah.
She got hair under her armpits.
Aww.
Fuck you. It's sexy, man. I'm just warning you, because some people go, oh,
that's
she got hair.
That's not sexy. That's animal.
How can you know all of that? It's...
That's Harry Garcia. That's in that movie Harry Garcia, the Ben and Jerry movie we're talking about.
Go check it out. It's pretty damn hot, man. But anyway, so she's like fucking way indie and stuff, and she's naked all the time.
Yeah, listen, this is the best Lana Del Rey has ever sounded, okay? So just leave these photos alone. And while we're talking about music, Rock and Roll Fantasy Camp. Have you heard about this? You pay a shit ton of money, and you get to play music, if you're like a weekend warrior in terms of guitar or drums or whatever, you get to go to this camp and play with big name rock stars.
Homer Simpson did it.
He's not real.
Is he, Ralph? Isn't he?
You go to Rock and Roll Fantasy Camp, you get to hang out with the likes of Gene Simmons or Roger Daltrey, and you get to train with them and hang out with them. They have done it around the country for a long time now. They've finally announced they're going to sit down in Las Vegas at the MGM Grand. That's where you're going to find the home for Rock and Roll Fantasy Camp. You will get to play with the likes of these major names in music, and you will pay the low, low price of $10,000 to jam with them and play a final graduating concert at the MGM Grand. It includes your hotel and meals, though, so you got that going for you.
So it's 10 grand for 5 days?
Yes.
Essentially, is that right? $2,000 a day?
Yes, it is, Mr. Wizard.
I'm not good at math. How can he know that?
That's the fastest white boy I've ever seen.
How could he know all of that?
All I'm saying is, this is going to be a staple in Vegas. You can go there at any time and hang out with Roger Daltrey and Gene Simmons and play.
For 10K.
Right.
That's pretty impressive.
I'm saying podcast fantasy camp. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah.
We need a fucking racket like this. We need to go to Vegas, and you can be the third chair with me and Kevin, and you can say shit about Kim Kardashian and stuff. You can sit next to us for 10K. We'll blow you, whatever it takes.
Wait. Bring it down. Bring the figure down, man. If you make it for like 50
bucks. Well, I'm
not
a cheap whore.
I mean, you got to put out a little bit, but maybe 10 grand's too high. I'd say something like, for our five days, podcast
you get to hang,
camp,
eat, smoke, and drink with us.
Like, I'd say that's $1,000.
$1,000?
We would sell out, dude.
Have you no self-respect, sir?
No.
For 5 days? $200 a day, that's what you're worth?
$1,000.
You're like Jim Rockford.
I am. $1,000, 5 days, times like 500 people. That's $500,000.
500 people. That's hardly a personal experience.
But we got 5 days to make it personal. All night long.
We'll work on it. By the way, next month, I guess we should tell people, we're going to be in Nevada next month. We're going to be in Reno.
Babel's anniversary is coming up. Not our anniversary. It's the 100th show.
Yeah, it's going to happen.
So for that, we're going to do it. Yeah.
We're doing Reno, Nevada.
In Reno, we're going to do a show Reno.
Tickets aren't on sale.
October 6th, I think it is.
And then 2 weeks after that, tickets aren't on sale yet, but we're going to be in Las Vegas, Nevada. We're going to be doing that at the Tropicana, too. So.
And in September, well, you know what, man? Hip the cats here in the room.
You want to really?
I think you should. I think, especially because they were kind enough to sell us out tonight.
All right.
Ralph's got a sweet-ass
fucking deal. I'm going to give you a little heads up.
This is a heads up. So if you've got a fucking smartphone or if you're carrying an iPad, or if you brought a desktop computer with you, you might want to jump on this right away.
Next week here at the Lovitz, we're doing the show again. We're moving to our brand new time, which is 8 p.m. on Saturday nights. A little bit earlier for folks who want to have dinner beforehand or party afterwards. We're going to do. We're moving to prime time, basically. It's 8 p.m. here at the Lovitz. And to celebrate, Kevin and I are both a little gay for Batman. How dare you, sir? And so, I don't know if you know this or not, but Batman Live is coming to town at the Staples Center.
Batman Live makes a Batman bottom very happy.
27th of September is the opening night of Batman Live, this major stage production about Batman and Robin.
We showed clips from it fucking eons back.
Back when it was in England.
Back when it was just in the UK.
So the folks at Batman Live know what big fans we are, and so they told us for next week's show to celebrate our new move to a new time. Everyone who attends Hollywood Babylon will get a free ticket to Batman Live at the Staples Center. Opening night on the 27th.
That's pretty sweet, man. So you get a Babylon ticket, and then you get a free ticket for a way better fucking show.
Yeah.
Very cool deal. So once they sell out, they're sold out. That's it. So that's for next week's show. People come to the Lovitz on September 15th.
15th is the date. Yeah, if you come to Babylon, you also get a free ticket for Batman Live opening night on the 27th. So
fucking
you got that
sweet,
going for
man. What a hero you are. You're a bigger hero than Batman.
I know.
Dude.
I didn't quit for 8 years. I'm right here. I'm fucking here. While we're talking about things Batman and otherwise, it's time for the geek news.
Ralph and Kevin, Ralph and Kevin, Ralph and Kev. Geek news.
Is Scott Tipton in the audience tonight by any chance? Hey, Scott, how are you? I want to give him thanks for giving me this story because it's an amazing story and I'm happy to talk about it at the top of Geek News. There is a Marvel Comics, well, he worked for DC too, a writer and inker named Carl Kessel. If you know his work at all, if you're a comic book fan, you know he created Superboy in the 90s, right? He wrote and drew everything from Superman to Fantastic Four over his career. But he is also a huge comic book fan and has a collection of comics that is spectacular. He is selling it all. He's selling all of his comic books for a very worthy cause. He and his wife have adopted a 15-week-old son named Isaac, who was born addicted to heroin. His mother was a heroin addict, and the baby was born addicted to heroin, and they are raising him and trying to help him through his withdrawals in his very young life. As you can imagine, a young baby addicted to heroin has no idea what's going on, and he is suffering, and he is has to deal with addiction to methadone and heroin. The medical costs, as you can imagine, are prohibitive, let alone the cost of adoption itself. So he's selling off his entire comic book collection since he was a little kid, and all of it is being done through Scott's company, which is known as Blast Off Comics. So if you go to blastoffcomics.com, you can bid on some amazing comic books for a very worthy cause.
Right on,
so I just want to give you a heads up.
That
medical bills
hero,
for the baby
man.
Already
that,
are $67,000 just in medical bills and $25,000 just for the cost of adoption itself. A lot of these babies born to addictive mothers are not adopted. So the fact that this couple did this is a remarkable achievement. And this, if you're going to buy comics, you want to add to your collection, this is the way to do it. So go to blastoffcomics.com. Just want to give you a heads up. Right?
And also, just to put like a little fucking sunshine on that whole thing, sometimes kids born addicted to heroin grow up to be Jason Mewes.
That's true,
so
yeah.
Shit could work out,
that's
you know?
Right.
Yeah, yeah.
Speaking of comic books, Venom, the classic Marvel comic book character Venom, is moving to Philadelphia. I can think of no better place for Venom to go. Having been born and raised in Philadelphia, Venom is going to make his headquarters now in Philadelphia.
Really? Of all played the city of brotherly love?
That's right. The editor for Venom Comics apparently is a alum of Drexel University in Philadelphia, and he's decided that
Drexel, the school of wizardry.
No, no. You're mistaken.
My bad.
Philadelphia needs its own superhero. New York has him. L.A. has him. He wants Philadelphia to have a hero. So Flash Thompson, a.k.a. Venom, is moving to Philadelphia.
Hand in the air. Well, since when is Venom a fucking hero, man? Does anyone remember the creation of this character? He was like, I'll eat your fucking head.
He was a symbiote that was bad, but Flash Thompson is trying to make him good. You know, he wears Venom so he can walk because he's all fucked up in his legs, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
I still, like, again, what part of fucking, like, I'm going to eat your fucking... He killed people. Dude.
Yes, but now he's like, I'm going to eat your cheesesteak. Ah. It's a much nicer, kinder Venom.
Hey, Ralph. I thought there was another superhero from Philadelphia.
Gay man. Oh, that's right. I forgot the gay ghost, also from Philadelphia. Don't get all cocky because one girl says your voice makes her come, all right? I'm slamming my hometown with the gay ghost jokes.
Why can you know that?
There's another superhero from Philadelphia too, James. Garman. Yeah. Boom! Boom, shakalaka.
How can he know all of that?
Yeah, how you know all that? The fastest white boy I've ever seen.
Garman is cute, dude.
G4.
That's cute. But basking it for a minute. Garman.
You like that?
What's your powers?
Enormous balls. I have enormous balls. I can knock out a villain with my balls.
Enormous balls is not a power. It's a
gift. Oh, really? I'll bludgeon you with my testicles.
With great balls come great responsibility.
That's true.
Yeah, that's how I defend
against that. An infinite capacity for alcohol, too.
Like a camel for fucking liquor.
Exactly.
Well done.
Geek Channel G4 is being rebranded. Apparently G4, the network we all go to for video games and comic books and geeky tech stuff, they are being changed over by NBC Universal that owns the network. They're taking them from geek to chic, they say. From now, it's going to be revamped, and it's going to be all like GQ magazine, fashion and decor for the modern male.
What about Attack of the Show?
Going bye-bye.
Really?
Yeah. Fresh Ink, the comic book segment that Blair Butler used to do, that's going away. Everything else is going away. They're going to rebrand it.
I like Attack of the Show. That's a good show.
No, it's going to be now Attack of the Sphincter, apparently. It's all
about
hair gel. Hair gel and metrosexuals.
There it is, man. That's a bummer. Well, they're a little. It's weird, too, in an age where like geek culture is like it, right now, pop culturally, at a nexus.
They're surrendering
G4. Yeah, why?
I wonder if it's because you can't get it on DirecTV anymore. They've had a contract battle with DirecTV, no one's watching. More sad geek news. Kick-Ass 2 is in the works, the movie, the sequel to Kick-Ass. Yeah, yeah. Hold your applause. I don't know if you guys are you reading the sequel to Kick-Ass, Mark Millar stuff. I mean, it's a great, great comic book. One of the characters, Colonel Starr, sort of leads up the what do they call them, the Justice Forever group, right? That's what they battle in. They just announced that Jim Carrey will be playing Colonel Starr in the film.
You know why are you making a face? That's not good.
No.
Why?
Because Jim Carrey is not good.
Wow. Really? He gets there. You go.
Alrighty then.
Were you never a fan, even back in the day?
Even back in the day, I didn't get it. I didn't understand why people were so excited. Except for Fire Marshal Bill. I did enjoy Fire Marshal Bill. That made me laugh. Wonder Woman's coming to television. Not the bad David E. Kelly version, where she ate ice cream and cried about guys. But the CW is doing to Wonder Woman what they did to Superman. Remember Smallville with the tales of young Clark Kent before he became Superman? Amazon is a new series in the works for CW. It's going to be her on that island of lesbians that she grew up on before she became Wonder Woman.
The whole thing just takes place on Themyscira?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
It's kind of hot.
I know. Girls wrestling, learning how to be warriors
totally,
and stuff.
Totally, man. I can't wait to see the episode entitled Harry Garcia. I would watch that, man. Artemis and shit like that. Yes. Yeah,
the girls in togas, wrestling. And
fuck the girls in togas. Well, yeah, fuck the girls in togas.
Yeah.
But just the fighting and shit. I don't know if you ever saw, we talked about it once on fucking Babylon. They did a Wonder Woman cartoon recently, like a DC Direct. Really fucking good, man. Yeah. And it was pretty tight. Rosario Dawson did a voice in it. But I think that could be done well.
I do, too.
I'd be into that.
And CW knows how to do it. Obviously, Smallville was 10 years.
Have you seen the Arrow stuff?
Yeah, it looks good.
It looks fucking good, man. It looks really good.
So I'm excited.
There's fucking Deathstroke's mask is in the first, like, 5 seconds of the trailer. They do a flash, and there's but you see it. I fucking saw it. I was like, skeet.
Oh, stop. Well, as much as I'd like to continue talking about Kevin's cock, comes the time in the evening we need to talk about someone else's cock.
Oh, we can't help but wonder, how big is Liam Neeson's cock?
Liam's got his own sound effects now. Of course, Liam Neeson's cock comes from Kevin's obsession with the size of Liam Neeson's cock. You can go to neesoncock.com if you'd like to read all the facts or add your own.
I love a world where that website URL exists.
I do too.
Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
It's who Clint Eastwood was really talking to during the Republican National Convention.
First couple are political.
Liam Neeson's cock is so big. On his trip to Canada, Mitt Romney roof-racked it because it couldn't fit inside his car. Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
People who wander into his pubic hair come out in Narnia. Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
It's as much wood as a woodchuck woodchuck if a woodchuck could chuck wood. Liam Neeson's cock is so big. Conspiracy theorists believe the moon landing was filmed on it. Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
It's what Logan ran from.
Logan's run.
Well, I was sitting there going, Wolverine?
No.
And then I fucking went
deeper,
in my head where he jumps
deeper
on his dick and fucking snicked into it and then rides it like a worm.
Oh, I just got a pee shiver.
Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
Liam himself has been diagnosed as a growth on his own penis.
That's rough.
Liam, more medical facts. Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
Doctors found a lump on one of his testicles and had to use the Death Star to destroy it. Liam Neeson's cock is so big. Ernst Stavro Blofeld has a secret base hidden inside of it. Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
That while video killed the radio star, Liam's cock killed the video star, the internet star, and Ringo star. Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
That even Christopher Nolan thinks it takes too long to reach a climax. Yeah! Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
Mary Poppins needs 63 carpet bags to pull it out.
Because she reaches in.
And lastly, Liam Neeson's cock is so big.
How big is it?
That when he wants to get an erection, he has to say, "Go, go, gadget cock!"
Ladies and gentlemen of Babylon, did you have a good time this evening?
Thank you so very much for coming out tonight.
Everybody give it up for the man who makes it happen, Ralph Garman.
And please to my good friend and co-host, Mr. Kevin Smith.
And that's Hollywood Babylon for this week. I'm Kevin Smith.
I'm Ralph Garman.
I'm going to fuck off. Good night, everybody.
Good night, guys. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, give it up one more time for Kevin Smith and Ralph Garman, Hollywood Babylon, live at the Lovitz.